things. Welcome to Duke, and thank you for coming to my lecture in spite of the surmountable obstacles. I prepared myself for this lecture because I know that most of you are still in high school, and I have a lot in common with you. I was also in high school once, but unlike you, I graduated. So. I prepare for you an overview of the kind of work that I do at Duke, and also I teach to my students. It is summarized here in these four words on the screen. Two of them, design and technology, sound like engineering. The other two, nature and evolution, sound like not engineering. My objective, really, at bottom, objective is to persuade you that all these things go together, and that contrary to what people think, there is no wall separating the so-called natural and the artificial. This is the reality, and I hope you get it. In my presentation is organized into two segments. The first is devoted to explaining the terms so that you understand my language. And the second one is to, again, try to persuade you that what you've heard in the first half is important to you, all of you, not only students, but also parents. So I begin with design. Design means configuration or organization. You see it here. This is a river delta. Here we have the lung of a person, you see it because something is flowing or something was flowing. So flow in a space that's free to morph, meaning a flow that is that possesses freedom, is the one that impresses us with configuration with what we call an engineering design. And the other big observation is this one. People think that this is inanimate, meaning a flow system without soul. That's what inanimate means. Whereas this one, we all know, is animate. Biology and geophysics, well, from the point of view of design and nature, they are one, not the different camps separated by an iron curtain. Next. You recognize that you actually know the principle behind these occurrences. If you went to a baseball game, imagine a sudden downpour. It falls on the neatly flattened infield, which is dirt but plain. And after enough time, you see rivers, river basins happening in front of you. First, here it is. It's a tree-shaped because from the area, the water has to get out through one side. And then the flowing is better. From 10 minutes to 10 minutes, it is still a tree, but it is a better tree. So this is evolution, incidentally. Evolution is not a word invented in biology. Evolution means design change in a particular direction over time. This time we see it in an inanimate flow system. And the principle is, in fact, this time arrow. The tape of evolution runs in one direction, not the other way. It runs toward easier flowing, greater access, and so on. You'll see those words, you'll hear those words very, very soon. With this idea on the back of an envelope, actually in a homework problem, the students can predict what nobody could predict before, which is that all over the world, large or small river basins, every channel should be fed by four tributaries on an average. The important thing to keep in mind is that freedom is good for design. In fact, without freedom, there is no design. Without freedom, sorry, to improve something in the absence of freedom is nonsense. The principle, the way I teach it, is spelled out here. For a flow system to persist in time, it must evolve, time arrow, freely such that it provides greater access to its currents. This is physics speech. All of you, especially the young ones, know this a good idea much better as go with the flow. If you can't beat them, join them. Find the path of less resistance. Be economical. Be smart. Get smarter. Take it easy, and do not jump over a cliff. That is the constructal law, which all of us obey unwittingly. Unwittingly is the key word in what is natural, in what happens by itself, in the behavior and movement of everybody, animate or inanimate. River basins, of course, vehicle water through what people think are complicated drawings of a few large and many small channels. Animals do the same thing. Animals are, in fact, buckets of water, if not water trucks. And their movement on the landscape is the same as that of the river channels. You see these actual ramifications if you go observing the migratory animals. But absent that, you can just look at the truck itself. It turns out that you can predict from the principle I just flashed on the screen that everything that moves, in this case through the air, should move such that the bigger are faster. And look at this. The oldest were many and small. The most recent are few and large. But they all obey the law. In fact, they all evolved into a constellation of examples that punctuate the law. So that's for flyers. We had even more fun discovering that what holds for flyers actually holds just as famously for runners and swimmers. Swimmers were the oldest, the runners are the second oldest, and the flyers are just the novelty. And in a few words, the conclusion, which is easy to demonstrate, is that larger animals should travel faster, should wave their bodies less frequently. Think of it, the elephant appears sluggish, low frequency compared with the running mouse. The larger should be stronger and should move a mass to greater distances. Pretty clear, meaning irrefutable. Even better, the bigger should also live longer and travel farther during lifetime. Here is the lifetime. M, I meant to tell you, is the body mass, the size. So the bigger live longer. Again, elephant lives a lot longer than the mouse. And also should travel farther during lifetime. This is true for everything that moves, with freedom to morph, to move more and more easily, for greater access, not only the animals, but all of us. I'll explain later who we are. We are not people. We are a human and machine evolving species. The rivers and the winds, the atmospheric currents, the bigger, the longer living and farther moving. And then I know some of you are saying, well, wait a minute. Talk about evolution. Everybody knows that one cannot witness evolution because evolution took forever. And what everybody knows is basically a parroting speech from biology. Evolution, as I just explained, is much more general. I gave you examples. And now I'll give you two ways in which to see yourselves in your lifetimes evolution galore. Sports, this is only one example. We've actually discovered many. The 100 meter dash. Well, again, everybody knows that records are meant to be broken. So upward is faster. What very few people knew is that the winners from one championship to the next who climb on the winners' podiums turn out to be bigger. So yes, Usain Bolt had an advantage among his competitors, the same way that others in their time surprised the audience by being fast and big at the same time. when I was a student, the big surprise to those of us who had nothing better to read under communism except the sports pages, Bob Hayes won the gold medal in Tokyo, and everybody was shocked because this was a Greek god, big, strong, and he beat everybody significantly. So the other place to see evolution is technology. All of you, I'm sure, came here, or most of you, flying. Look at the airplanes at the gates, from year to year or decade to decade. This is the 100-year-old or long history of commercial aviation. And on the vertical, the sizes of the new models that invaded the skies. The oldest, just like the insects, were many and small. They were joined by fewer and larger, up to, say, the largest, say, the 747. The largest are joined by even larger and even fewer. So this upward movement toward not only size, but complexity and larger numbers is natural. This is the way to invade the world with our need to move. And again, from the principle, you anticipate, you predict what I just showed you, but also everything about the moving animal, meaning the aircraft. Look at this. The engine size is 1/10 of the total size of the airplane. From the beginning, 1950, to, these are jet engines plotted, until today. These are designers, actually armies of designers here, USSR and elsewhere, not talking to each other. But through hard work, they discover the same animal over and over again. Not only the proportionality between engine and body size, but you also predict fuel load should be about 1/3 of body size. The range, the distance traveled during one because of one fuel load is proportional almost with the body size. And the biggest surprise is that all airplanes should look the same. Their wingspan should be nearly the same as the fuselage length. Amazing, but this is the way to be. If you are just like the birds, incidentally, if you forget about the picture here with the engines of the 747, you can read this little summary and think that I was giving a lecture about zoology. Here is the musculature. Here is the food. Here is whatever, the range, the life travel. And we know about body length and wingspan. Everything that flies looks the same. Oh, sorry, should look the same. Why should they? Because it is the law, you see. Now, why is this important to know? After all, science is for us. It's about us. Who cares about the insects? It's about us. And this is who we are. My colleagues, most of them teach that the human is this. In fact, here is the picture from the anatomy book. That is actually incomplete. It may have been true, I don't remember when. In fact, I don't think that was ever true. People have always contrived to empower themselves, to use the twig, to use the things around them, shelter and all of this, in order to live better, bigger, longer, and healthier. In a nutshell, because I teach thermodynamics, which is the science of converting fuel into work or power, in a nutshell, we are in this blue design world, and our activity, bodily and through our mental capacity of equipping ourselves with good ideas and devices, from era to era, more of the fuel spent is converted into work. We're getting smarter, and as a result, per unit of fuel spent, we get more more work for our use. The question that was not asked until we showed up is what happens to the produced work, or per unit time, power? Well, here's the blue human and machine species. Here is the work that came from the fuel. This work is destroyed immediately for the purpose of moving something. This something that moves does so by overcoming the resistance of the ambient, friction against the ground, elbowing your way into the stadium crowd, and all these other things. The environment doesn't get out of the way on its own. The mover must overcome the resistance of the environment. The mover must have impact on the environment in order to move. And as you saw from the principle, to move means to live. So the brakes dissipate this work into heat from a long distance, heat in from the fuel, heat out 100%. And in the meantime, inside the box of the human and machine species, mass, stuff, moves on the map of the world. Meaning we, through our lives, reshape the Earth's crust. The animals have been doing the same. The river basins have been doing the same, but for much longer. How do we do this movement? We do it with design or with organization. I'm sure many of you will fly through Atlanta. This is a very good example. It's an icon of urban design. An area shaped in such a way that anybody arriving at any gate has easier or easiest access to the entire area, to any possible gate. So from this point to the area, from this other point to the area, and so on. It turns out that if you take everybody's urge to get into and out of the airport the fastest, you discover that the shape of the area should be this one. And this shape is such that it's easier to remember if you remember this bottom line, that the time to walk, which means along half a concourse, is the same as the time to ride on the train that bisects the concourses. That time is 5 minutes. Another way to say is that the long and fast should last the same as the short and slow. A rule that, or another way, is to remember the line from the military, which is, it's basically not smart to hurry up and wait. Okay? Same time, both ways, where it takes two ways to move in order to cover an area. Short and slow, yes, and long and fast. If you don't know the Atlanta airport, you know your own neighborhood. Here's the city block, one large street with large vehicles, allows the material carried by the large vehicle to cover the entire street, because the short and slow here is basically moved by many and small vehicles. If you are not curious about your neighborhood, maybe you did study biology. In that building, they call it the food chain. On the same area, few large animals, which are fast and long traveling, coexist with many small. Why? In order to vehicle over the entire area animal mass. Together they collaborate, you see, they collaborate toward plowing and plowing and covering this area with mass. Going back to the formula for urban design, now at a much greater scale, this is the essentially the western half of Europe, from the Black Sea to the Atlantic. The long and fast are the air routes, shown here in red. The short and slow are the traversing of the yellow, the actual land. Imagine flying from London to Milan. It's about 2 hours. Well, those are the same 2 hours that you need to get out of the Milan airport, find a car, and cross the yellow on the way to the hotel on the beach. You see, long and fast, the same time as short and slow. Your mind jumps to even larger scales, and the largest, frankly, that interests me because I know it, is the globe. It's the same thing. The entire globe flies. This is actually an exact image of all flying aircraft 10 years ago. This came from NASA. It is based on the measurements of condensation trails behind all flying aircraft. Basically, everybody, the whole world is in movement, like the red blood cells in the human circulatory system. But sooner or later, all the blood cells flow through the two chambers of the heart. So the world has a heart with in this case, two chambers, very few vital organs. And this design, this animal, is going to stay this way. It will get better. The aorta will become bigger. Even the capillaries will become bigger. But nothing is going to change the picture so it becomes a uniformly flowing vasculature, meaning nothing is going to reduce the size of the big and increase the size of the channels that are positioned in the armpits. That would be unnatural. So hierarchy is another name for the natural emergence of efficient, longer-lasting organization. The world that I showed you on the map, once again in the upper right, can also be reviewed this way. Every black dot indicates the country in which a particular citizen lives. On the abscissa, I plotted the fuel use per capita. So more fuel consumption to the right. On the ordinate, I plotted the same thing, but is known by everybody as wealth, gross domestic product per capita. There's an alignment of the people on Earth. At the very top, meaning leading the peloton, you see the expected the lucky ones. Trailing are those who would like to be in the upper right. What's important here is that there's a time arrow once again, from the many small to the few large. Everybody is racing upward on this bisector because the urge to have wealth is natural. But now we learn that this urge is synonymous with the urge or the need to find and consume fuel with purpose. There's another observation to strike you with. Look at the per capita use of fuel in the US. It is the same as in Russia. So the same use of fuel per capita, yet the American citizen is 10 times wealthier than the Russian. Why? Because of position in the vasculature. The former is in the aorta. The latter is somewhere in what is equivalent, in fact, of the slow-flowing marsh of the river delta. So geography matters, and history also matters. A final way of looking at the same world picture is this one. I showed you on the vertical the wealth per capita. And on the abscissa, I plotted the index of economic freedom, or the competitiveness rank. And this alternative view of the world reveals another important pattern. The world is of two kinds. Places characterized by wealth and freedom. Those are characterized by wealth and staying power, or peaceful change. And then the rest, which would like to be like the former, which are in fact characterized by the complete opposite, which is poverty and catastrophic change. Important to keep in mind is that there is a time arrow or a direction in which everybody is racing upward. We have already established that is equivalent with racing toward freedom. So rulers and designers of rule of law who do not recognize this tendency to the left are destined to lose, okay? Because the natural tendency is toward the upper left. And this brings me to my conclusion, which is actually spelled at the bottom. With science, we become amazingly powerful. We have the power to predict the future, and more than that, we have the ability to construct it and to walk into it with confidence. With regard to the world, that means, obviously, channels will be open. You see this in the city traffic evolution, roads better, wider, straighter, liberated flows everywhere, better technology, better science, and rule of law, another natural happening, constantly improving, and that's also true of the government. So this is my story for you, the visitors, and also the parents. And if you'd like to know more about it or tell your friends, here is a popular book that tells the story with even more pictures. Thank you very much.